That is indeed true.
Yes.
Okay, if my friend Adi had one, I have to have one. Okay, thank you all for coming here to listen to my second lecture. So yesterday I talked about basically three things, mostly about spin qubits, because I knew that would be discussed extensively today. But I also talked a little bit about two kinds of topological qubits. One, fractional quantum Hall, this nu is equal to 5 half state, and the other, the superconductor semiconductor sandwich structure, where you have Majorana fermion. Both of them are same kind of topological system. They're both essentially chiral p-wave spinless superconductor. And the other things that I work on are graphene and topological insulator. My talk tomorrow will be entirely on graphene and topological insulators. In fact, what I'll talk about tomorrow is a comparison of these two systems from a transport perspective, just that. And the other thing that I work on, the sixth subject, cold atoms, I will not talk about, but I think I was probably a bit reckless in showing my value judgment on that. So the thing that I'm going to talk about is I showed you a slide yesterday, and there was a little bit of discussion where I was a bit dramatic deliberately to exaggerate the point that I said that, well, has this exotic particle with which you can do topological quantum computation through braiding, has it been seen? And then after that, I showed the Delft data, and I said, here it is, okay? And today what I'll discuss in reasonable depth is a rather narrow question, and the question has been given there as a question in the title of my talk, okay? And I'll give you an answer at the end.
So because of inflation, $1 billion question has become $1 billion.
No, this is a $1 billion question. You know why? This is probably not an exaggeration, because suppose the whole world agrees this is the Majorana fermion. There is no question about it that this is a robust qubit that has no decoherence. Very unlikely to happen. Knowing my physicist friends, I don't expect anything like that to happen. But suppose that does happen. Suppose everybody says yes to that answer. I think it's bad news for all the speakers in this conference who are not working on this, because the funding will all flow to this, and it will become an engine. Bad news for me also.
Oh, so it's $1 billion.
No, it's negative for us, but it's positive for somebody. I mean, I will not be funded anymore either, because then it's an engineering project. Then it's a question of, how do you make the quantum computer, you know, with this? So the answer to this better not be definitively sure, okay? If we all want to survive. But you know, I will try to give you a serious answer. And this possible $1 billion question is just to intrigue you, and because this is the kind of thing you do in the first slide. You know, you're allowed to do this kind of nonsense in the first slide. All our papers are posted here. I'm going to cite very few papers. So let me remind you what a Majorana fermion is. I assume this was discussed in the school, but I did not change anything because of the school, so I'm going to go through it. A Majorana fermion is a localized zero-energy quasi-particle mode which emerges naturally as a subgap excitation, since a zero-energy is subgap, in spinless pure superconductors at suitable defect sites such as 2D vortex cores or 1D wire ends. It could arise in other places also, but today I'll be talking about this Majorana. The sigma particle in fractional quantum Hall effect, it carries charge for technical reason. That's also a Majorana. Majorana could occur in other situations, but I'll be talking about this Majorana. Give me a spinless chiral PUF superconductor, and I will give you a Majorana by creating either apply magnetic field or a vortex, or the core of the vortex will be zero energy mode. Lo and behold, that's a Majorana. Okay. So this has zero energy, zero charge, zero spin. It is its own antiparticle. That's why it's called a Majorana. The nomenclature may not be very good, actually. It suddenly leads to a lot of confusion among my high-energy friends. That's why this is the Majorana part. And in our case, Majorana in high-energy physics, if neutrino is Majorana, neutrino will not be non-Abelian anionic particle. It will be just an ordinary fermion. Our Majorana, which occurs in two dimensions, although you can take this two-dimension and make it happen in 1D, even in 3D, but it's fundamentally a 2D object, carries non-Abelian anionic statistics, which is the part that allows it to be used for topological quantum computation, as has been discussed. So, you know, it's, in some sense, somebody once said, it's as close to nothing as anything can be. You know, zero energy, zero charge, zero spin, So it's a zero energy bound. You can think of it as zero energy bound neutral non-local superposition of half an electron and half a hole. I'll explain what I mean by that. It always occurs in pairs because in nature, at least in our naturally occurring solid state systems, either semiconductor or cold atoms, you do not have half electron or half hole available. To have superposition of half electron, half hole, you must have two of those objects coming in so that, you know, you can create them with real fermions. And if those two majoranas, so majoranas are always come together, but if you can somehow separate those majoranas very far, then you have unpaired majorana. Only then you can do topological quantum computation. So this is what I'll talk about. So just a little bit history, since this thing is called majorana, I should tell you who majorana was. So majorana was a great Italian theoretical physicist who was incredibly brilliant. You can see what Enrico Fermi said. Enrico Fermi compared him with Galileo and Newton. He said, there are many categories of scientists, people of second and third rank, who do their best but do not go very far. This is, okay. Then there are also people of first class who make great discoveries, which are of capital importance for the development of science. And then there are the geniuses, like Galileo and Newton. Well, Ettore was one of those. This is a pretty good recommendation. You know, all recommendations are exaggerations, but when you read a lot of letters of recommendation, you know that, okay? So the point is that but it does make a difference if somebody's compared with Galileo or Das Sarma, okay? There's a big difference, okay? I mean, you're going to be reducing from both, okay? The person who's been compared with Das Sarma probably has not written as many papers as I have, okay? But the person who's been compared with Galileo may not be Galileo, but it's going to be damn good. So this, and you know, Fermi actually put his money where his mouth is. You know, what I found out, Majorana's famous paper, this paper that led to Majorana particle, which I'll discuss in a minute, Majorana did not think anything was worth publishing. He was exactly my antiparticle, okay? It is a great stroke of irony that I have become his biggest champion, at least one of the biggest champions, okay? But given the number of papers I published, his biggest champion, period, okay? So he did not think anything was a problem. He basically, in today's world, we'll call him a depressive. He was clearly a manic depressive person. You know, he could have used Paxil. But the thing is that he did not want to publish it. So Fermi acted as Majorana's secretary. He wrote the paper up. He submitted to the journal just with Majorana's name because Majorana said, why do you want to publish it? Nothing. So Fermi said, no, this is an important paper. He wrote it up. He sent it to the journal with Majorana's name. And Majorana has meanwhile vanished. So Majorana was born in Sicily. And then he was taking this boat ride from Naples to Sicily, and no one ever saw him. And there are all kinds of rumors. You can see some of them. He disappeared, okay, right after writing this paper, before this paper's publication, in fact, or maybe right after it came out. So the rumors are he retired to a monastery to escape spiritual crisis and to embrace deep Catholic faith, jumped overboard in suicide because he was manic depressive. And I have heard of a possible item C because one of my ex-postdocs, Enrico Rossi, who maybe, was he at? No, he's from Texas, so you did not know him. Enrico Rossi, Alan McDonald's student. So Enrico Rossi is Italian, and he went to a special competitive school in Italy, which is named after Majorana. So I deferred to him. He must be more knowledgeable about Majorana than either Wikipedia or I. So he told me that, this is all nonsense. Majorana moved to Argentina. And everybody knows that apparently his school. He moved to Argentina. Apparently Majorana had a little fascist inclinations. But one of these three things. Nobody knows what happened. All right. So a brief history of Majorana Fermion. The question Majorana asked, like other great geniuses, Majorana apparently didn't like complex numbers. You know, all of you should know who another genius is who didn't like complex numbers. Great Ramanujan. Ramanujan did not believe in complex numbers. Everything he did was with real numbers. And some of the theorems he proved. Some of the theorems he wrote down the answer to, okay? No one knows today how he did that just with real numbers. Because he did not believe in complex numbers. He was, you know, a very simple person, I guess. And Majorana was like that, did not like complex numbers. So he asked this question, the Dirac equation, which has an I, is there a real solution possible? And the answer is, of course, it's possible. Take a linear combination. What? Well, No, he probably, yeah, he did not. You can go to Argentina and ask him why not. So maybe he did not think Schrodinger equation was worth thinking about. Wasn't deep enough. You never know. So the solution is obvious. You know, you take a linear combination of that, and he wrote down the solution. And so it has to be electrically neutral because it will be its own antiparticle. So gamma. Now, you know, there is no reason to jump up and down just because something is in one own antiparticle. A lot of people don't realize that, so I added this thing recently. All bosons are their own antiparticles. So particles being their antiparticles is everywhere. But for fermions, it's basically unheard of unless you go to supersymmetry. So it's unusual in fermions. But Majorana actually had an agenda. I mean, he's clearly a deep guy. Majorana thought this new thing that Pauli has conjectured, neutrino, may be this thing. Okay, so it's not like he was just not doing abstract math or, you know, just pure theoretical physics. And that was his kind of hypothesis. And in fact, this hypothesis is still open. Neutrinos may very well be Majorana particle. At least two very famous experiments going on, one in Italy, one in South Dakota in the United States, deep in mines. There are certain neutrinoless double beta decay experiments. People are putting the error bar on whether Majorana is or is a neutrino is or is not a Majorana. Right now, it's not clear. You know, either statement could be true. And the neutralino, which is a supersymmetric particle, is by construction Majorana, never mind. So this remains open. But the question we are interested in is it possible that Majoranas will emerge naturally as emergent low-energy mode in condensed matter system, okay? And what if that happens, what we are talking about, of course, you don't have fundamental particles. You only have electrons. You know, in solid state, you have a great advantage. You have only electrons and photons. We don't have anything else. Holes are just absence of electrons. So the possibility that we are talking about is, in some sense, much more profound than what Majorana thought about or what neutrino. In some sense, it's more profound. In some sense, less profound. We will not have a fundamental particle that's a Majorana particle because we have no fundamental particles. They're just electrons. But what we are talking about is the realization of Majorana operator itself. That, in some sense, is much deeper than just a Majorana particle. So the possibility that the Majorana operator itself could be realized in low-dimensional condensed matter system, if that happens, then you can do topological quantum computation. And as far as I know, this question, perhaps not in exactly in this form, was first asked by Steve Garvin's colleague, Nick Reed, in late 90s, you know, that can the Majorana operator itself be realized in condensed matter physics? So the question is, how can it emerge in something as mundane as semiconductors? And this is the rest of the talk. So let me start by saying superconductors are natural hosts for Majorana particles. So why am I saying that? You know that superconductor, the ground state in some sense, you can think of the ground state as a condenser of Cooper pairs. Ground state is filled with Cooper pairs. You can just take Cooper pairs, throw them out, add Cooper pairs, it doesn't make any difference. And this was alluded to in several talks today, I guess, is that in a superconductor, charge is ill-defined up to 2E, and that's because the ground state is filled with Cooper pairs. Excitations are not Cooper pairs, that's the ground state. Excitations are this so-called Bogoluba quasi-particle, which are excitations above the ground state, and they are in this linear combination of electron hole. This is an exact symmetry, this linear combination of electron and hole operator. Okay, this is an electron creation operator, this is a hole creation operator. Now, you see that if you can somehow make U is equal to V star, then you get an object, gamma, this operator, which will be operator and it's conjugate at the same. Gamma will be gamma dagger. So if you have U is equal to V star, then gamma is equal to gamma dagger. So superconductor is where you want to look for a Majorana particle. Because superconductor already have an object where it's, you can call it almost Majorana, because a linear combination of electron and hole operator, it's not its own complex conjugate, but if you can reach the point is equal to V star somehow, then you get this realization of Majorana operator itself. Now, what is the magic that allows it? The magic that allows it is this thing that superconductor is vacuum in superconductor is filled with arbitrary number of Cooper pairs. So you can take an electron and it can convert into a hole. This is called Andrew reflection. And all you are doing is that you are releasing or capturing a Cooper pair. So this is what allows, and this is what Nick Reed basically realized. Others kind of knew it in a variety of different ways, but he had the crisp understanding of what was going on. And so what you have to do is, it turns out that when U is equal to V star, the energy has to be zero. So you have to look for a zero energy state in a superconductor. Okay? If you have the zero energy state in a superconducting gap, Once you have a zero energy state in superconducting gap, you are home free. There is no problem. That object will be a Majorana, okay? And people knew that it could happen. That's correct. That's correct. That's the right way to think about it. Yeah. Now, the problem is fermion doubling. You know, electrons come with spin. So you can do all these things, but if you have spin, then two may not be on top of each other. You will not have anything. Okay, that's not going to help. So fermion doubling is, of course, a very fundamental theorem. Okay, so you have to avoid fermion doubling. So somehow you need spinless superconductor. So spinless superconductor means PUF superconductivity, because spinless means all the spins are polarized, right? So if the spins are polarized, then the spin sector is symmetric. So the other sector has to be anti-symmetric. So the simplest that you can have is PUF superconductor. And I found out last time I gave this talk about a month ago that you can have topological superconductor, which is F-wave also, because any, you know, P, if P is okay, F is okay, but I'm going to talk about only P. So you need a spinless, and by definition, if it's spinless, at least it has to be P-wave, it cannot be S-wave, so you need a spinless F-wave PF superconductor. REST is actually pretty straightforward. REST is single particle physics, is band structure physics. Rest of my talk will be band structure physics. So then you can convert BCS equation to something called Bogoliubov-Dejean equation, which gives you all the properties of these excitations. So this is your Bogoliubov-Dejean equation, and there is this exact symmetry that I told you in superconductor particle hole symmetry. You can look at this equation. If UV is a solution, this is the superconducting spinner, the Nambu spinner, that if UV is a solution, then V star U star, if UV is a solution with energy E inside the gap, then V star U star is a solution with minus E. Okay, so this is called particle hole symmetry. This is an exact symmetry for superconductor. And you can see at E is equal to 0, these two have to be the same, because E is equal to 0, E is equal to minus E, right? If E is equal to minus E, then UV and V star U star have to be the same. Electron is the same as the hole. So this is what the whole thing starts from. And so what can happen then, that if you can change some parameter, so you have this extra zero energy solution. So this is called a topological superconductor when you have this, because you have the zero energy Majorana mode here. You have realized the Majorana operator. And the trivial superconductor, I'll use the word trivial superconductor to mean something that doesn't have the zero energy solution, doesn't have a Majorana. So trivial solution doesn't have the zero energy solution. How do you go from this to that? I'm trying to explain to you very physically why this thing is considered robust, why it's considered that this thing is immune to local perturbation. This zero energy solution is neither an electron nor a hole. So it cannot just randomly disappear with little perturbation, because this is a real thing there. If you just add a little disorder or throw in a few phonons or send some photons, it cannot just spontaneously go from this to there, because where is this thing going to go? Almost all the topological phases have something concrete like that, some number, some concrete discrete object, which cannot disappear just because there is some perturbation. Okay? Same in topological insular Z2. They have many differences among them. You know, some of them have fractional statistics, some of them don't, some of them have Majorana, some of them don't, but all of them have some discrete feature which cannot disappear just because of some local perturbation. That's where the immunity comes from. So here, and this was first realized by Reed and Green for sure, here to go from this topological phase to non-topological phase, you have to close the gap first. Because if you close the gap, then you have a continuum of states, then you can make this disappear, because the continuum state, it doesn't matter, you had a discrete state vanish. So this is called a topological quantum phase transition. You change some parameter, you go from the topological superconductor to the trivial superconductor, but you must go through the vanishing of the gap, because otherwise the zero energy, and this is the topological immunity. Okay, this is why you can do quantum computation with it, because this thing cannot vanish with little local perturbation. Okay, so I told you yesterday already, I had a modified version of this slide that I showed you, that there are various proposed systems. People have been working on it for the last 10, 12 years. I have been working in the last 10, 12 years. Others have been working on it longer. So the earliest system was fractional quantum Hall, five half state, specifically the five half state. Then once we all understood that this is nothing other than a chiral spinless PUF superconductor, then we said, okay, what about working with chiral PUF superconductor itself? Forget fractional quantum Hall, you know, high magnetic field, high mobility, very low temperature. If we can somehow find a chiral PUF superconductor in nature, a little piece of solid material that, you know, a grower makes, then that would be great. Or in AMO system, maybe you can design them. And then there, in a very important paper, Fu and Ken pointed out that if you take a regular 3D topological insulator and then bring an SF superconductor close to it, then the surface states, if you can induce proximity effects, just S-wave proximity effect, there will be Majorana there. Okay, I'm not going to discuss this. This was an important development. And soon after that, we realized, in fact, we had a paper around the same time, we realized that you don't even need a topological insulator. You can do it very simply. This is Jay Sau's work. You can do it very simply by having spin-orbit coupled semiconductor and a spin splitting, and SF superconductivity, and there are three several versions of this. You can do in 1D nanowire, you can do 2D heterostructure, or you can do in cold atomic system, and people are actually working on all these three systems. This is the system that being most intensively studied, but atomic physicists are working on it. In fact, there's a beautiful paper by Martin Zuerlein in Physiobleda 2 or 3 months ago where he has taken the first step in realizing this, and I think there'll be much more to come here, much, much more to come. So this is where the experiments are going on, 5 fractional quantum Hall effect at Lucent, Alcatel-Lucent. I forgot to correct it. Bob Willett pointed it out to me. Alcatel-Lucent, Bob Willett is working on it in Chicago. Uyan Kang is working on it, and there are others. Topological insular superconducting systems at Stanford, David Goldhaber Gordon, and then topological superconductor. Yoshi Ondo is working on it, not exactly this system, but related. Spin orbit coupled AMO system, my colleague Jan Spillman at NIST, Martin Zuerlein at MIT, and there are others. Strontium ruthenate, this is a chiral PUF superconductor. There are some problems here. People are working on it, like Dale Van Harlingen at Urbana. And the things that I'm going to talk about is the semiconductor-superconductor hybrid structure. This last thing that I showed you, these two things, mostly the second thing, where experiments are going on. And there is Delft, Purdue, Lund, Wiseman, Copenhagen, Charlie sitting here, Santa Barbara, Grenoble, and possibly other places. So this is a big subject. A lot of experimental groups are putting a lot of efforts in realizing Majorana in the semiconductor nanowire. So the rest of my talk will be on that. So this was theoretically predicted. In a PhysRev in 2010, we told the experimentalists exactly what needs to be done. Okay? I mean, literally exactly what needs to be done. We said that take a superconductor, niobium or aluminium, doesn't really matter what. Take something that will make very good contact with semiconductor so that the interface is very nice. Okay? Put an indium antimonide or indium arsenide nanowire. Any material would do, as long as the material has very high spin orbit coupling. What the material is, we do not care, high spin orbit coupling. The ones that are well known in 3.5 is this. And then apply a magnetic field along the wire. Then we said STM, but any kind of tunneling measurement. There'd be a tunneling measurement, just superconducting tunneling measurement at the end. And what you're going to see that if the magnetic field is large enough, then there'll be a zero bias peak. And that zero bias peak is the Majorana. If the magnetic field is not large, then there will not be a zero bias peak. The peak will be outside the gap, the usual peak. Okay, there'll be nothing at zero energy. One can even say exactly at what magnetic spin splitting. I'm not going to talk about magnetic field. I'm going to talk about spin splitting, Zeeman splitting. Zeeman splitting has to be larger than square root of the chemical potential square plus the induced superconducting gap here, induced superconducting gap, not the superconducting gap here, whatever gap you're inducing there, square of that. So this is the topological quantum phase transition, and of course the theory also said the gap must close there. Okay, and in fact, there is a paper by Krishnendu Sengupta sitting here in which I'm a co-author also, going back to 2001, a paper written long, long time ago, where the zero bias peak associated with Majorana was first predicted. That if you have a Majorana, not in this system at all, the system we had in mind is organic superconductor, where Majorana probably doesn't occur. But what he pointed out there, Krishnendu calculated, in fact, we did not even make a big deal about Majorana. We just have one sentence. Some people call it Majorana, is what we said. Apparently, Krishnendu trying to convince Yakovenko that you should say more, but Victor did not. So nobody knew about this paper until very recent line, including me. I mean, I knew the paper, but since it's organic conductor, I forgot this one plot we have inside. Then one day, I suddenly remembered that we did this, and I go back and look at it. Sure enough, so there we pointed out that if you have a Majorana, you'll have a zero bias peak. Okay, so this is what was predicted, and the peak should be quantized in 2E square over H. That's the important thing, okay? There should be a peak at zero energy, peak should be quantized at 2E square over H, and the peak should go away when you decrease the magnetic field, at zero magnetic field, for example, when you're in the topological phase. So this then was, and I will give you the other references also, there are many references talked about it, but the reason I'm starting with this reference, none of the other papers, you probably heard about paper by Oreg et al. And Luchin et al., none of them told experimentalists, do this zero bias experiment, okay? They all said there will be a Majorana. Zero bias experiment was proposed in this one, okay? So the point is that this is the paper that said, go ahead, do a zero bias experiment. The paper that I first wrote, the first PRL that talked about this with Roman Luchin, we talked about fractional Josephson effect. The paper by Oreg et al. Talked about various things, but did not talk about zero bias peak. So this is the paper that told you that easy experiment will see it. And then then Leo Cohn have made this sample. This doesn't quite look like this, but believe me, this is topologically equivalent, okay? It's exactly the same. Here is a nanowire, indium antimonide nanowire. Here is a superconductor. And this is, he did not do an STM experiment, although he's trying to do it. Here is some kind of tunneling contact, okay, gold, to do the tunneling measurement. And here is something coming in so that he can pinch off the two-dimensional electron gas so that he interface. So, and then he saw the zero bias peak. Okay, so this is the induced. So what is being shown is voltage here, some voltage applied along here so that you can have tunneling. And so this is the superconducting gap. So you can just see the superconducting gap is roughly 250 microvolt. This is a superconducting gap induced in the nanowire. In niobium, the material is niobium. In niobium, of course, superconducting gap is about 1 MeV. This is niobium titanium, 1 MeV. And the induced gap is 1/4 of that. So this is a superconducting gap. And then each of these plots corresponds to higher and higher values of magnetic field that they're applying along the wire, okay? So the experiment is very easy to understand. All it is differential conductance as a function of the voltage for different magnetic fields, and then at some magnetic field, a zero bias peak comes, and then it stays, it doesn't change, and then at very high magnetic field, something happens. This is the experiment that excited everybody. This is the experiment that got written up everywhere. It's unbelievable, the sensation it created and how nonlinear it became. I'm not going to show you all the newspaper articles saying things. For example, there are articles saying that Leo will become very wealthy because this is a thing. Yeah, everything has been studied. Anything you can think of, trust me, has been studied, okay? So I will talk about all of them, okay? But anything you can think of in this one-hour episode, I can trust you, five groups have studied it. Okay. These are very smart people, so.
Where is it located in that wire?
Oh, it's at the end. I'm going to come to that. It's at the end. It's at the end. So here it would be wherever the superconductivity ends, you know, so here, it will be here, okay? Here. This neuron will be here somewhere, okay? It could be a little bit farther, it could be here, it could be a bit inside there, but it's at the end. Whatever the end of the wire is, whatever that means, okay? It may not be the actual geometric end. What is the end? Wherever the superconductivity is ending, okay?
Majorana wave function has some localized character.
Yeah, yeah. It is localized, not some localized character. Majorana is localized. That was my first slide.
So I was wondering whether that size...
Those things all come in. All those things will come in, okay? And this has been repeated by others. So this is beautiful data from Weitzman, done by Das et al., Mori Heiblum's group. This is a different system, indium arsenide aluminium. Very similar data as you see. Zero magnetic field. The gap looks a bit different. Then as he applies magnetic field, some zero bias peak. This is data from Lund. Not as beautiful data, but still there is something here. Okay, zero bias peak. This is Charlie Marcus's data. Hugh Churchill took it. I think this is also in his Harvard fridges. Two different samples. This is indium antimonide niobium. I think that I'm paraphrasing Charlie. This is to, the goal was to reproduce the delp data. Charlie, correct? That was the goal. And it's beautifully reproduced. Okay, again, it's not identical, but the basic feature is reproduced. Zero bias peak as a function of magnetic field. Zero bias peak as a function of magnetic field. And here is data from very most recent one, from Del Van Harlingen. I mean, these are really world-stop groups, you know. I mean, we're talking about people like Charlie Marcus, you know, Leo Kuhnhaven, Mori Heiblum, Del Van Harlingen. We're talking about very serious people. And they are all putting their names saying that, okay, they have seen zero bias peak. Here is Del's zero bias. This is the most recent paper. This is indium arsenide and niobium, okay? So both the combination of indium arsenide, indium antimonide, and niobium aluminium have been studied. And these are the things we talked about. So this is what everybody's excited about. And these are papers that actually predicted the thing. This is the first paper predicted in 2D. Then two papers more or less at the same time predicted it in 1D, which is just dimensional reduction from this 1D. And this is a long paper that we have, which talked about the whole thing plus how to see it. And this is the theoretical experimental paper that started that. Now, the motivation was that, you know, best thing would have been if there's some material that you can just go and mine which has chiral pure superconductivity, spinless superconductivity. It does not seem like anything like that exists, okay? Strontium ruthenate comes close. I don't want to talk about strontium ruthenate. It's not quite what you need. So the attitude of many of us was that if topological superconductors, the Majorana fermions, do not naturally exist in nature, we could possibly engineer them, wrong spelling, engineer them using generic ingredients, using very simple, since we know what is needed, and since Bogolubov did, we're talking about real system that, you know, Marcus or Jacobi would study in the laboratory. The physics depends on many, many different things, okay? I did not even put temperature here, but superconducting gap of the original superconductor. It obviously depends on the tunneling strength between the semiconductor and the superconductor, because if the tunneling is zero, you're not going to have any proximity effect. It depends on spin-orbit coupling. It depends on Zeeman splitting. It depends, obviously, on chemical potential. Obviously, it depends on disorder. There are all kinds of disorder. It may depend on superconducting disorder, but Roman Lucin and I showed that it does not depend on superconducting disorder. It's a non-trivial point. Patrick Lee, you know, an incredibly smart man, wrote a paper saying that it is affected by superconducting disorder. And we had to point out to them that, no, it doesn't. And we had to exchange email for months before they published an erratum saying, no, it does not depend on superconducting disorder. So it's a very subtle point whether what disorder depends on. But it definitely depends on semiconductor disorder, depends on disorder at the interface. It depends on how you have that. It depends on wire length. It depends on, you know, John Martinis claims it depends on 16 independent experimental parameters that he knows of, okay? And it may be more. But at least six of them I have discussed already. Even in a minimal model, you will need six, which are the original gap of the parent superconductor that you're using, okay? Then the Zeeman splitting that you are controlling. Then the spin orbit coupling. Then the lambda, does the coupling, the tunneling, not the coupling, tunneling between the superconductor and semiconductor. Because if that's very small, you're not going to have any proximity effect. Cooper pairs have to go through. And gamma is disorder, but I'm just calling it one parameter. There may be many different kinds of disorder. And then chemical potential. So a minimal model plus temperature, which is not a parameter, which you can change, okay? So even a minimal model has to have six things. So it's a very complex problem, okay? And there are others, you know, that I don't want to talk about. You know, what exactly the confinement around the end, all those things matter. And if you go into the archive, you'll find that every single thing you could think of, somebody wrote a paper on it. And there are other things that people have not thought about, but those are pretty subtle. So some of these things we have looked at, some of these things others have looked at, but let me just summarize what you need, you know. So you need very large superconducting gap. You need large, but not very large, superconducting semiconductor tunneling. You need as large spin orbit coupling as possible, but you do not want very large Zeeman splitting. You want obviously as low semiconductor disorder as possible, but the superconducting disorder doesn't matter at all. So if to make superconducting gap large, you use the most amorphous material, like niobium, titanium is, that's fine, because superconductor gap doesn't come in. There is an Anderson's theorem. As far as superconductor disorder goes, there is no Anderson's theorem as far as semiconductor disorder goes. You want very little chemical potential fluctuations. If a chemical potential fluctuation, this thing will be destroyed. No, superconductor side, there is Anderson's theorem. Yeah, actually, it's even worse than that. I'll show you, okay? We have solved the problem, full RG problem. But yeah, you are right. There is a phase transition from topological superconductor to topological insulator. That topological insulator is still, you can still do topological quantum computation, but unfortunately, you have to do it at zero temperature because that object is gapless, okay? So you need good interface contact. You know, you didn't ask me, but on the semiconductor, maybe there are many subbands occupied. It doesn't have to be in the 1D limit. In fact, it typically is not 1D limit. You have to take that into account. All these things come in, and obviously, I'm not going to be able to talk about all these things. So let me talk about the disorder. So many people asked us about disorder that Jay and I decided that we have to really work this thing out. And it turns out you can do an Abrikosov-Gorkov theory. So Abrikosov and Gorkov did this beautiful theory. This also goes by the name of Anderson theorem, but Abrikosov-Gorkov actually worked out the thing. What they showed is that if you have ordinary momentum disorder, it doesn't affect SF superconductivity. They actually solved the problem, the Nambu-Gorkov formalism, I guess Gorkov and put in disorder, solve the problem self-consistently, and showed that, you know, in the perturbative regime, disorder doesn't do anything. So Abrikosov Gorkov adapted for this PUF spindle superconductor, and then what we did was we included that effect of disorder in Born approximation and self-consistent Born approximation. You know, anything better, you have to do full numerical work. And the result we found is, there is no way I can explain all of these things, okay, because this is very, very complicated. But I will just tell you, that the result we found, we get actually a formula. This is the formula of how the induced gap depends on scattering in the semiconductor. Okay, it's a very nice, completely analytic paper. So instead of discussing these results, because there are just too many parameters, you know, discussing it, there is no way you are going to follow it unless you read the paper already. Let me just show you some plots, okay? So what I'm showing here is a plot of spin splitting, which is what you're using to drive the phase transition, against over here, against this parameter gamma, okay, for some fixed value of lambda, what is the lambda used? So lambda is, remember, lambda is the hopping parameter between the superconductor and semiconductor. Lambda controls the proximity effect, and gamma controls disorder, okay? So everything else is being kept fixed, everything else. We are just changing spin splitting, Zeeman splitting, and disorder. What is the feature that strikes you on this plot? When you see it, what do you see? You see all black, basically. Black is useless, okay? Black is a zero-gap superconductor. You cannot do anything with the black part. So obviously, if you have very small disorder, you're okay. If the disorder is large, you need very large value of VZ to see anything. So you see that this is the range where you can do generic topological quantum computation. Okay, of course, if you increase the strength of the spin-orbit coupling, then the scale will go up. Okay, so let me not discuss. This is just same for fixed disorder. This is not for fixed disorder. Let's see. Disorder here is 0.2k. So let's say disorder is 0.2k. Now I'm changing lambda. I'm changing the hopping between the superconductor and semiconductor. Everything else fixed. This white is a trivial superconductor. Again, here you see that there is some region where topological, but it's black. You want to stay away from black region. But you look at it, you realize that you need to have fairly good systems. But the point is, the reason you do experiments is that theory cannot be trusted completely because all theories are approximate. Your spin orbit coupling may be larger than what you think. This is a part arbitrary Born approximation calculation. Maybe, you know, if you go Born approximation, things are going to improve. This is, I took from, the font somehow changed. This I took from, this projection. This I took from John Martinez. He has spent a lot of time replotting our formula. He has spent a lot of time on this formula, huge amount of time. It's actually very impressive and has plotted in all kinds of different ways. So this one I really like. So he asked the question that suppose I want a gap, induced gap, which is 100 microvolt, 1 Kelvin, okay? What would I need? Okay, what would I need? So he's plotting it as a three-parameter plot. Here is the superconducting gap that the parent superconductor will have. Here is the spin-orbit coupling strength, and then the color is mobility. So if the mobility is very, very low, let's say, okay, only 20,000, which is actually not that low, then you need rather large spin-orbit coupling. As you go to higher and higher mobility, spin-orbit coupling could be lower and lower. So the point one is making is that you have severe constraint on all the parameters, and one has to worry about it eventually if you're going to build a topological quantum computer. So this work I'm not going to talk about because I could have given a one-hour talk right on this. So this is in PRL. You can read it up. It's just showing that we can do theory. This is really not my style, but Alejandro Lobos, who is a postdoc at Maryland, is an expert in RG technique. So what we did is solve the problem within part derivative RG completely in the presence of both interaction and disorder. So it's a Luttinger liquid. We assume the 1D system is a Luttinger liquid, and we had to use replica technique to handle that. It, of course, flows to strong coupling, but you can numerically integrate the thing, and the answer is exactly what I told you for large disorder. Disorder of the order of gap, you have nothing. You have an Anderson insulator, as you said, okay? But you know, those of you theoretically oriented, you can look at it. It just gives this result, but now it's not just a leading order result. It's a full RG theory. Ruchin and Theodore Stanescu showed that for multiband system, everything I told you goes through. As long as you have odd number of bands occupied, that means as long as you're spinless in the highest thing. Let me not discuss it. Everything goes through exactly the same way. Actually, things may be a bit better if you have a few bands. Certain stability features come in, but it's a detail I don't want to discuss. So let me now show you some results, okay? So this is Theodore Stanescu's rather nice numerical simulation. So what he does is that he takes a wire. Here is the Majorana will be located. And what I'm showing you is that here is a situation where he does a simulation with the spin splitting smaller than the topological this thing. So it's a trivial. By the way, these are not schematics. These are actual numerical calculations with indium antimonide parameter. I'm giving you the wire length he used. And everything else that we used are indium antimonide spin orbit coupling and niobium gap and so on. Okay, so when you are in spin splitting less than this, nothing in the gap. This is a superconducting gap. Of course, you have a lot of density of states above the gap because this is just a continuum above the gap. But in the gap, you have nothing. But the moment you go satisfy this condition, beautiful Majorana shows up. Vashkaran, this is what you're asking me. Of course, it has some wave function width. At the end, it's some wave function width. And the reason it can't be too close, then these two wave functions will start talking to each other and they'll split. Okay? This is more pictures of that. I'm going to discuss all of that. This is for multiband, for example. This is one band. Multiband, you get when you have two subbands occupied, you do not get Majorana. They are both not at zero because now you do not have a spinless system. When you go to three, you have again one right at zero and so on. Okay, so all of these things, you can, if you know how to use the computer, you can take Gogol Division equation and just diagonalize it, you're going to get these results. Tudor produced this result, what it would look like if you actually do a DIDV measurement. This is all before experiment. All these are in papers before experiment, not after. And what I'm showing is that, what he showed is that, again, when the magnetic field is small, nothing much would happen. Then when the magnetic field just passes the topological condition, you'll have this peak, and here is gap closing, and of course, experiment, and this experiment system, this is at B is equal to zero, they're seeing beautiful induced gap, and then they see it looks pretty much like theory. But it's really not like theory. If you look at the theory, this is theory. When you look very quickly, it looks like theory. But when you start looking carefully, it doesn't look like theory. In theory, a gap closes. I have made a very big deal to you that the superconducting gap must close in the topological position. In experiment, you can look as long as you want. There is no gap closing here. You can see this. Nothing is closing, right? Just this thing shows up without gap closing. In theory, you can see the gap closes. And where the gap closes, the peak shows up, and then a new gap opens up. So this is the topological gap, and this is the trivial gap. Trivial gap must close. Experiment, there is no sign of that. And the question that Krishnendu asked me, this is related. This size of this peak should be 2e square over h. This peak is 0.02e square over h, factor of 100 smaller. Okay? So that's not very satisfying. And so let me just summarize the good and bad in the data. Okay? Good in blue and bad in red. So we predicted, theory predicted, a zero bias conducting peak, and experiment sees that exactly as it is predicted. Okay? Theory said there should be a peak, they do the experiment immediately. In the very first sample, this is the peak. Okay? But on the other hand, the peak is weaker by a factor of 50. Theory says it should be exactly 2e square over h, it's much, much smaller. Okay? So this needs to be understood. ZBCP occurs roughly at the right D values. Why am I saying roughly? They don't know exactly what the chemical potential is, but roughly at the right value. Okay? But absolutely no signature of the bulk topological. This is the item that bothered me the most. This work was first presented in a very highbrow conference exactly a year ago in a beautiful island in Caribbean, Virgin Islands, a Simons conference, where there were just 15 of us. Leo Cohn hadn't presented because he could not talk about it until he published it. He presented this data first. When he showed this, Pete Brewer and I jumped up exactly the same moment and said, because Leo was saying it looks just like theory. We both said it doesn't look like theory. Gap is not closing. Okay, and this bothered me a great deal until I think at least we found one possible solution of this problem, which is coming out soon, I think. So you have to understand this. I'm going to talk about this. Zero bias peak is robust to magnetic field. What I mean by that, the magnetic field is going up. The peak stays. The peak doesn't disappear. If it is some spin-related phenomena, as you increase magnetic field, you'd expect it to move, right? Spin-related phenomena moves as G mu B, but it's not moving, so it's staying at the same magnetic value. It doesn't move with chemical potential either. That's good. That's very good. That's what theory says it should be. It's robust to magnetic field and get voltage, but there is some splitting at high magnetic field values, which I'm going to talk about later. Rotation, so it matters whether your magnetic field is along or perpendicular orbit direction, and it's a trivial effect. I'm not going to talk about it. The experiment found that if they rotate it, it goes away exactly as it should. I'm not going to talk about it. One thing that has bothered me a great deal, and it's still not completely solved, but we have a possible solution lately. If you look at the superconducting gap, this gap, this doesn't look like any gap you saw in textbooks. Superconducting gap usually looks like this, you know, very hard gap. And this is an incredibly soft gap. Okay, lot of sub-gap conduction. Lot of sub-gap conduction. It absolutely looks like it. In fact, people ask me, are you sure there are not a lot of nodal quasi-particles here? It looks like D-wave. Exactly. Okay. So a lot of sub-gap conduction, which in D-wave happens because you have nodal quasi-particles. Okay. So, you know, so where is the sub-gap coming from? Okay. And the last thing is that what is the splitting oscillation? And this I'm going to spend some time, a minute or two. Let me just tell you what I'm talking about here. The mirrors here are not infinitely separated because the word that Delft people use is only 1 micron long. So the two Majoranas see each other. They should split. What is that? So all these things I'm going to talk about. Let me first start with the questions Krishnendu asked. What does temperature do? That's an obvious thing. So So we calculated what the height should be of this peak if you take at finite temperature. See, the problem was, experimentalists, of course, knew that. They plotted things as a function of temperature right here. What they noticed is that if you extend it to zero temperature, it's not going to 2 square over h. It's still remaining a factor of 10 smaller. So that, people say, oh, it cannot be. I think this problem is resolved. What we showed is that is true only in an infinitely long wire. In an infinitely long wire, it's indeed true. When you go to zero temperature, your thing will be exactly quantized. In a finite wire, there is always a little bit of overlap, and you have to take that into account. Yes?
The coupling also will reduce the height, right? How strong the coupling will be.
That will too. No. The thing is, that depends on how you're doing the measurement you're talking about. We are assuming this measurement is really measuring this perfect under reflection. Okay? No one has extremely realistically modeled the real tunneling contact because you don't really know what it is like. You know, you saw the picture. Okay? So what we showed, the point I emphasized was that once you take into account the fact that it's a finite wire and finite temperature, then the peak height could be much, much smaller than 2. Okay? And eventually, if experimentalists in principle can, and they will. It has not been done yet. In fact, the depth wire is the longest wire where the experiment has been. Other words are even shorter. So all of them see values much, much smaller. But yes, this has to be checked, definitely. Okay. But at least we have one possible solution that more or less everybody agrees with, that it must be temperature. But we showed temperature by itself is not enough, because then as you lower temperature, now it's possible that they're low in temperature, things are saturating because of electron temperature. But I would say this problem, although it's a problem, but people are not incredibly concerned about this thing. So this, I would say, was the biggest problem, that if the gap doesn't close, you cannot call it Majorana, because you cannot say there is a topological superconductor. And the solution we came up with, and you know, this is just, I guess this is just one possible solution. Nobody has proposed any other solution. Okay, there is another possible solution. One is not seeing Majorana. This physics has nothing with Majorana physics. Gap is not closing for a very good reason. There is no reason for the gap to close. That solution is not publishable. So this is the only, you know, publishable solution I know of, which is assuming that you have a topological quantum phase transition. In fact, I have already given away the answer. The tunneling is taking place at the end. Gap is closing in the bulk. So the spectral weight of the gap is very small at the end. Now, this, having this idea is very simple. Doing the calculation, you need someone like Jay or Tudor, and we had, I had both. So we could do the calculation. Once the idea was there, in 3 days, the calculation was done. What I'm showing you here is that you have to really measure what experiment measures local density of state, not global density of states, okay? Because the experiment is measuring things here. So in local density of state, you are not going to see gap closing because you are at the end. What are you dominated by at the end? At the end, you're dominated by the Majorana wave function. Okay? So all the spectral weight of your LDOAs is the Majorana. So if you look at, you know, the local density of state, Majorana shows up, but the gap closing doesn't show up. But the same thing, if you look at total density of state now, you see beautiful gap closing, and depending on where you are, you may or may not see the Majorana. Okay? If you, for example, now the other thing we said, that okay, let them do the local density of state measurement in the middle. So we told them that go ahead, do the tunneling measurement in the middle. Then what are you going to see? Something like this. You're going to see gap closing. You're going to see the gap will close here at the middle. Gap will close, but no Majorana. Why no Majorana? Because now you are doing the measurement here. No spectral weight from the Majorana. Am I clear what I'm saying? So in one case, you will see just this. You will see Majorana. That's here. X is equal to 0. Other case, if you do it here, you're going to see gap closing, but you're not going to see Majorana. This is the current explanation that community has accepted. This may not be the final explanation, but it's a reasonable explanation, and if somehow they can do an STM, they can move the STM anywhere they want, and then the experiment should be easily done. I think this is an extremely important experiment to do to confirm this Majorana. If the gap doesn't close, there is no topological quantum phase transition. What about long wire versus short wire? So when the Weismann experiment came out, I was very concerned, because the Weismann wires are very short. In fact, let me tell you how short they are. They are shorter, actually they are some situation much shorter than the coherence length. Well, then the two Majoranas should see each other. And so we are very concerned that if the wire length is much, much longer than coherence length, there is no problem. Then you can say Majoranas are well separated. But the wire length is comparable to the coherence length, which is what most of the Weismann data was. We did not see any reason why they should see ZBCP. Why should they see a zero bias peak? There is no Majorana split. And in the other limit, when wire is much, much shorter than coherence, you should have nothing. So what I'm talking about is, since time is short, let me just show you this is the plot I like. So let's look at this Majorana as a function of length of the wire, you know, what you are asking. Theoretically, you can do that. Experimentally, you have to do different work. Theoretically, you can just take the same system and just increase L as you're doing a numerical work. So when the wire is very long, so we are just solving the low-lying, I'm just showing you the low-lying eigenenergies of this Bogoliubov-Dejean equation. Let's first look at this thing, gamma is equal to 2, spin splitting is 2. When you go to very long wire, you have a Majorana. You have just one zero-energy state. You see that one zero-energy state, okay? Which is degenerate because there are two that have come into one, okay? When you have a very short wire, what do you see? You see large splitting because the two Majorana see each other. And this splitting has oscillations. This is basically RKKY oscillation, okay, which actually we predicted even before this Majorana thing came up in 2009. If you take the spin splitting, you make the spin splitting very large, not spin splitting, this is not spin splitting, this is the gap. If you make the gap very large, that means coherence length is very short, then this thing is even stronger, right? Because if the coherence length is short, then the two Majorana see each other. So basically, the short wire and the long wire are adiabatically connected. So in the long wire, you have the Majorana. In the short wire, they split modes, but they're adiabatically connected. There's nothing, no phase transition, anything. This is just a crossover. Now imagine you're doing an experiment. All experiment has some energy resolution. No experiment is done at zero energy resolution. Suppose your energy resolution is such that you're cutting off here. Well, you're not going to see split peaks. It would look like a zero bias peak. So we think that's what is going on in these experiments that I'm showing you here. This is our theory. We just put some finite resolution. Then this part that you're seeing looks like it is zero bias peak with some, you know, with some breadth. But eventually it kind of comes apart again. Eventually you should see some oscillations. And seeing Majorana oscillation is very important. And I actually want to talk about Majorana oscillation. This is the Majorana qubit state. Let me just. So actually, it's an important point. This is connected to the Majorana oscillations. So somebody asked me yesterday, why does this thing work as a, what is the qubit? So I already told you what the qubit is. Remember that Majorana is half an electron. Two Majoranas together is either an electron or nothing. So that means once you have two Majoranas, that the physical state would be either it's one fermion or nothing. That's the qubit, okay? So once you have two Majoranas, they could be as far from each other. Doesn't matter. They could be, you know, one could be here, one could be in the next galaxy, but they are still non-locally coupled, and either they will have one fermion together or zero fermion. That's the qubit, okay? So two Majorana fermions encode one real fermion, and that's the qubit. But that's only true if they're not split. If they're split, this thing doesn't work. So that means if you really want to do topological quantum computation, it's very important that you don't have large splitting, because if you have large splitting, they're not Majorana, they're not non-Abelian. So this was, we actually did this long before Majorana experiments were done. We pointed out there'll be these oscillations if you have Majorana, you know, if they see each other, and we even analytically could calculate the splitting. And more recently, we did this numerically. And what is the splitting? Yeah, they see a little bit of splitting, but not much. You know, experimentally, the original paper of Modic et al., they have in the supplementary session a statement saying, we see some splitting somewhere, but nothing general can be stated. So this thing was then kind of studied, this is the paper that's coming out, studied in great depth by Tudor. Essentially, what we found is that if the wire is short, you should definitely have splitting, but how large the splitting is depends on whether the experiment is done at constant density or constant chemical potential. Everything I've talked about so far, I have assumed the chemical potential is constant, but it's possible that in a real density is constant. You'd say, how? You're controlling a gate voltage. Why density becomes its chemical potential? Reason is electrons interact by Coulomb potential, and they don't like changing density. So it's possible, it's like, you know, that effect, and Jay actually calculated this, incorporated this, how to do it, and what we found is that typically constant density shows much suppressed Majorana oscillation compared with constant chemical potential. So blue is constant density, yield is constant chemical potential, but even in constant density, there should be some oscillation, but it's much suppressed. So we wrote this paper where I think my only contribution was absolute insisting we must do this. You know, this is an incomplete story. We must predict that there should be oscillations and tell them about the oscillations in, and then using the smoking gun in the title, which I had to fight real hard with FISREP to keep the word smoking gun. They don't like anything that's interesting. FISREP, by, you know, by definition, if you have something interesting in the title, they change it. So they change it to something really, really dumb.
No smoking.
And gun. They told me I'm not smoking. No gun either. Okay. I mean, basically that's what they said, the guy who wrote back to me. Said that we don't allow words like smoking and gun in the title. So I had to send them back the Wikipedia page in ultimate authority that smoking gun is a perfectly acceptable thing here. I had to write like a 2-page legal brief. Then they shut up. Then they realize it'd be too exhausting to, you know, continue this, that I was not going to give up. So the thing is, what we predicted in this paper is that direct observation of a splitting of the zero bias conductance peak, as you increase magnetic field, will be the smoking gun. I really believe that it's kind of a smoking gun. And we showed what it would be, and we pointed out that if it's constant density, the oscillations may be suppressed, but there should still be oscillations. You're never seeing any oscillations of splitting, then we don't see how it could be Majorana. As the magnetic field is very high, your gap is very small, coherence length is larger than your wear, there should be splitting, and those splitting should oscillate, and you should not be able to do topological quantum computation. If you don't see that something else is going on, so I really thought it's smoking gun, and it's going to establish everything. There's a little problem. So this is the same figure. This is what you're talking about, these oscillations. I'm not making it up. Within a week of our prediction, three groups have seen these oscillations. Okay? Three experimental groups, Harvard, Charlie Marcus is the one who first told me he saw. In fact, you sent me an email next day saying that you have seen these oscillations, okay? Because you already saw them. That's why, you know. So in our paper, actually, we do say that we suspect every group has done these experiments already have these oscillations in their data. And they, because how can they not have it? And that's exactly what happened. So both Harvard and Delft presented in a conference, but Anna was smarter. They posted it, okay? Del Van Harlingen posted a paper, NMLS modulation of zero bias peak, and basically saying this is have found a smoking gun. And that worries me a little bit. A smoking gun verified within a few days of the posting of the paper is a bit worrisome, but you know, I'll take it while the going is good. All right, so basically what...
Gun control legislation.
Yeah, right. So the thing is, what are these modes then, these split modes? They are not quite Majorana, but they're obviously some mixture of electron holes, so I'm calling them almost Majorana. I was calling them pseudo-Majorana. And Xinhang Wang at Microsoft pointed out that's very bad terminology. It will remind people of pseudoscience. A lot of people believe that Majorana is pseudoscience anyway. So I should change the word from pseudo to something else. So I'm calling them almost Majorana. So what you're saying is that these are, I think every experiment is seeing. Now I'm trying to give the answer posed in the original title. I think what people are seeing is almost Majorana. They are not Majoranas because the wires are not long enough. There is overlap. And the fidelity is very low. You can use, I'm not going to go into the details, you can use computational fidelity. You can, Jay and I have estimated, it's, you know, the most liberal estimate gives us 90%. So these are way below ion trap, way below the system you have it in, because of the splitting, you know. And why is the splitting? How do you think of the splitting? If you can do a braiding very fast, much faster than inverse of the splitting, it doesn't see the splitting. They're Majorana. Okay? So you said, do the braiding very fast. What's the problem in doing the braiding very fast? If you did very fast compared with the inverse of the superconducting gap, then it's not Majorana either. It's again the problem I told you before. In quantum computation, you can never do things too fast. You can never do things too slow. Here you are constrained by the fact no actual experimental Majorana in a lab is going to be exactly zero energy mode. There will be some splitting. So you have to do things fast compared with that splitting, but slow compared to the superconducting gap. If you say superconducting gap here is not very large, only 250 microvolt, and let's say the splitting is 10 microvolt, so you don't have much dynamic range, and this is why. But these things will improve. People are going to do longer wear, these things. So right now there is no exponential protection. You may have heard that, you know, this Majorana gives you exponential protection. That's why you don't have to worry about decoherence. Right now these are actually certainly worse than Amir Jacobi or Charlie Marcus' spin qubits, and IBM and Yale transmon qubits, you know, their protection aspects of them. But there is a clean way of improving it. You know, you have to make the well longer and so on. Right now there is no. So while in Majorana wave functions overlap, and the almost Majorana is not a precise zero energy mode, and, you know, but the almost Majorana goes continuously to the topologically protected Majorana as L over psi increases. So you can either increase L or increase the superconducting, induced superconducting gap. Both will give you the same thing. So this is a continuous crossover. There is nothing. Well, I mean, in principle, you should do it a mile, in which case your protection will be e to the power minus 5 million or something like that, okay? Then you can really brag. In reality, 5 micron would already give you 99.99%, you know, for It depends on the gap and so on, but the current thing. So anything 10 micron, you can brag that this is by far the best qubit. So I think that this is the best answer I can give you, that that this thing is likely to be Majorana. I cannot give you a guarantee it is, but even in the best circumstance, it is an almost Majorana because of this. And, you know, for it to go into Majorana, so currently observed Majorana, I do not believe is non-Abelian because of this, because the two Majorana see each other at best. Of course, I cannot rule out the possibility something completely different. No one can ever rule that out in physics. That is something I did not think about. There is a paper, very nice paper, saying that Kondo gives a zero bias peak, Kondo does, but that's a very, in the Coulomb blockade regime, certainly, that's in a small dot. In a small dot, of course, you're going to say, small dot, we don't have any of this physics. Can all of it be Kondo? I think it's unlikely, but can I guarantee it's not? No, I cannot. You know why I cannot? Because this where may be split into a bunch of dots. They have so much chemical potential fluctuations in there. Maybe I have a huge number of charge impurities. It's broken into little dots, and all they're seeing is just physics of each dot. How can I rule that out? That has to be ruled out experimentally. There is no way I can rule that out. I think it's unlikely, because why would that happen in the same way in five different labs with five different materials and so on? So this is the best I can do, that perhaps these are almost Majorana. If they're almost Majorana, then there's a clear line to improve them. I do not know whether that would happen or not. And that's where I think I'll stop. Thank you very much for your attention. I can hear you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
No, 1.2 micron, yeah. No, 5 micron is good enough to beat all the current thing. 10 micron, you can really talk about topological protection. Delft is 1 micron. That means the Majorana separated by less than that, because Majoranas are not going to be exact at the end of the wear. 1 micron. And, for example, the Modi Heiblum is really like, it's 0.3 micron. What matters is where the superconductor is ending. Most of these are in the short wear limit. Remember, all these experiments are basically the first experiments. And the fact that all these experiments came with less than a year of topological prediction. So these are not in optimized samples at all. Okay? And so things can only improve. Yes, you had a question. You better use the microphone.
So you might have skipped that Roman Jacques's contribution to the Majorana modes.
Who? So go on.
Could you give a little?
No, he was. Yeah, he was. He doesn't even use the word Majorana. He was working on 1D Dirac equation, one of filter work. There are these solitons which turn out to be the same as what you are calling Majorana. But it has nothing to do with the Majorana I'm talking about. You can map the Kitaib model into that.
Question. Right. They can be mapped, right?
Yeah.
So let me understand this properly. You have two Majorana fermions at the end of your wires.
Let's call them Majorana modes.
Majorana modes.
Right.
So if it's a wire, how are you going to do the braiding in this case?
Oh, I did not touch those things at all. That's a huge subject. And there were at least two talks where that was discussed.
Okay.
It's a huge subject in which we have some papers. There are many schemes to do that. I'll just outline what.
Okay.
Right now, my interest is only establishing whether this object is Majorana or not, because everything else is irrelevant after that.
Okay.
If this turns out to be not Majorana, all the beautiful schemes for braiding will not amount to much, right? So that's why I didn't talk about that. But the scheme is that one scheme that that somebody described today very well is this mapping scheme that you basically what you can do. I have to show you the picture because otherwise I will see in my mind what I'm talking about, but you will not. I want to get to the actual structure, actual physical structure. Coming. Okay. So let's say, for argument's sake, the Majorana is here and here. Okay, just for argument's sake. Okay? So you want to now move this Majorana somehow. The way to move it is that you can now have a gate here and just deplete this completely of carriers. Then this Majorana will go away. But let's say you have now another wire here where you bring the gate in and create a Majorana there. Then the Majorana has gone from here to there, and then you can just make any geometric pattern you want. Now, it sounds like what I'm saying some kind of science fantasy, but it has been worked out in many different groups The first paper is by Alicia et al. Jay and I have some papers. So there are at least 15 papers in the literature where people have shown that in 1D, you can do this very easily. It's not so easy to do in 2D with vortex. You have to move the vortices around. 1D, you can just gate it, and turning the gate on and off or turning the magnetic field on and off, you can move things. There are other schemes. This is just one scheme. So there are various schemes for braiding using this idea. Okay, quite sophisticated, and all of them show that it works.
So basically, while braiding the two end Majoranas, you can make it in such a way that they don't see each other.
That's correct. Okay. That's important.
That's what I wanted.
If they see each other, then of course it's not going to work. Yeah. But those schemes have been worked
out. So that's
out.
What I couldn't figure out in
no, no. That's because I didn't talk about it at all. Okay. This is the, if I talked about it, the whole talk would be on just braiding. I could not talk about any of the other things. Okay.
Yeah, last question. Maybe. Your density of states, which has the
right.
There are at least two possible origins. One is, even though Anderson's theorem protects superconductivity, but it fills
actually,
a gap with...
Since you asked, you gave me an opportunity. It's actually into two possibilities. It's six different possibilities, at least. Okay, we have a paper where you asked. So the question is, why is the observed gap so soft? This is a paper we have submitted in PRL, which means for the next 6 months, I'll have to do battle. So there is a soft gap. Why is the gap so soft? This is the classic gap you expect in a good superconductor, okay? So this is something that bothers me. This has nothing with Majorana, because you see, the gap is already soft at B is equal to zero. So this is an proximity effect question. Why is the proximity gap in this system so soft? So let's forget about Majorana, forget about topological superconductivity. This is the question in basic solid state physics that I should be able to answer. So it was really bothering me. And we have a paper, we have a paper on the archive posted a month ago. But it turns out this soft gap is quite generic whenever you do superconductor semiconductor proximity effect. So I did not put the references, but these are Majorana related papers, and these are papers from a long time ago, nothing with Majorana. You see, gap is soft. Okay? So in all thin film systems, it seems the gap is soft. So I ask the question, let's think of these are, you know, one good thing about working with good people is that they're very good. You get to do a lot of good work. The bad thing is they all leave you. If they're good, they get good jobs and they leave. So I'm not working with new people at Maryland, okay? Sotake, Benjamin Fregoso, Hai-In Hui. These are names you have not heard, but hopefully you'll hear these names more and more. So I told them, let's do a systematic study, putting in every possible effect that at least I know that could give a soft gap. Possibly. First thing you'd say, momentum disorder. If we put a lot of momentum disorder, that's going to give a soft gap even in SOS superconductivity. You know, even Anderson's theorem is not absolute, as you know, if the density of state is suppressed. Magnetic disorder, Shiba. Many other things one can think of, you know, dynes, inelastic process. You know, this is classic superconductor. This is something I know. So included all those processes. I'll just summarize. You should read the paper. The effect that we find, and I'm interested in hearing what you, that we think is the most important, is the fluctuation in the hopping between the superconductor and semiconductor. And that hopping fluctuation, why would that hopping fluctuate very much? Because that hopping is exponential in the interface length parameters. And any fluctuation that gives you very large fluctuation, and the problem basically becomes like a power correlation problem. Because what is happening, the superconductor gap in your nanowire is fluctuating exponentially. And if you have any break there, then your gap will be very soft. And we are finding that just a 10% fluctuation at the interface, you know, physical parameter, like length, gives us This is theory now. This is theory. This is not experiment. This is theory. Okay? And it gives us, and my student is Hai-In Hui, pretty smart student. He actually did Rabrikosov-Gorkov theory, putting that in, and theory is giving that also. But we did solve the, this is solving this numerical is quite demanding, because we had to segment it, you know, in different parts and then do a lot of averaging. You need huge amount of averaging. And so we've said in this paper that we think this is the main reason, but it's also possible there is some quasi-particle poisoning, which can never be ruled out, you know. There is some sub... Yeah, so the tunneling parameter, instead of making it uniform throughout the thing, you use a microscopic theory to obtain the tunneling parameter. So what is tunneling? Tunneling is e to the power something, right? So that something is some distance parameter at the interface. And so we said that distance will definitely fluctuate, because as you saw, even these beautiful objects that Michel is making with STM, there is some fluctuation in the interface. It's not zero, okay? And what I'm saying is a 10% fluctuation in that interface, and these are not MBE grown samples. These are just, okay? So 10% fluctuation in that will give us this soft gap. So that's this result. Okay? Does this satisfy you? Okay.
In fact, that was one of my points. The second one was...
I told Christian, anything anybody can think of, trust me, somebody has thought about it.
The second one was, when disorder increases,
right?
Even though superconductivity is produced, you get lots of Bogoliubov quasi-particles with low energy, which are localized.
Absolutely.
So they could be hanging around in
this region. They do. And those we call fermionic gap states. And you see them all the time in this numerical simulation. Okay? Right. And that's absolutely, but you need a lot of them to get this soft gap is what I was trying to say. Okay? They by themselves don't do it. In fact, my original hope was that they would resolve the problem. But they don't. The amount that you need is unrealistically high. Okay? So this paper systematically gives results for all of them. And of course, all of them are going on. But I like to commit when I write a paper. You know, I don't want to say, maybe this, maybe that. I mean, why are you writing the paper then? So here we say that we think that this interface fluctuation is the main enemy, you know. And this is the thing they have not perfected at all. I think in the next generation MB-grown sample, this is going to be better. Okay?
Absolutely last question.
Yeah, sorry, I'm not going to hold people just one small thing. When this length is of the order of coherence length,
right.
Should we think a little bit about whether we can do this Bogoliubov-Dejean formalism and get the states? Because, you know, there are, I mean...
No, you can do it. Bogoliubov-Dejean, I think, still applies. We are not doing theory. We are doing numerical work.
The delta that you put there, if you put a mean field gap out there...
So I will put what you're saying differently. Maybe we agree. Okay. What you're saying, shouldn't you solve the problem self-consistently now? That's what you're asking, okay? So in some of these cases, we have done that. Not all, okay?
It doesn't change.
No.
Okay, I think...
One last one? Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So my question is, it's a challenge.
Yes, please.
Because I think that we're fabricating samples in a kind of a coarse
way. I agree.
Given the existence of things like NDE. And it's also the case that even though aluminum isn't perfect superconductor for these materials because it tends to go normal in a small field,
it's a fact that every grower of semiconductor heterostructures, either wires or two-dimensional electron systems, has aluminum in their growth chamber, which means that they can grow graded concentrations of whatever that goes all the way up to 100% aluminum in principle. And so my challenge to you is, could you design a heterostructure with a layered system that contains aluminum. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know whether you can make it or anyone's ever tried to do this kind of thing, but it's a superconductor that's already in people's growth chambers. And I don't know, and people have asked me, what should I grow? And I don't know the answer.
No, this is a good question. Can you make a more composite structure where aluminum is built in at a first principles level? Because they can do it in MB much more easily. I haven't thought about it, but it's a worthy challenge. I don't know whether I'll be up to it or not, but let's talk about it, and I promise to think about it.
Thanks. I have a mic. Okay. So since tomorrow the world is coming to an end, we should have the banquet today. It's in Sheraton. I hope you guys know where it is, but I'm going to give the list of how people are going to be picked up and the transport from here to Sheraton. So the event starts at 7. Okay. I need those who are staying in Sheraton to leave now, in the car. Okay, because the car is waiting for you outside, because these cars will go drop you and come back so that some more people can go in them. Okay, so that's number one. The faculty members, as well as students who are from outside Bangalore, we will arrange transport for you outside the main physics entrance over there. Please be here by 6:15, which means you're not going anywhere. Okay, you're going to be here. We have about 5 to 10 minutes. Okay, the students who are staying in Jalahalli, the bus will take you there at Sheraton, and we'll have to leave around 10 o'clock so that they can drop you at the right time. Okay. Those who would like to go from here, faculty members of IISc, please be here by 6. For the students in IISc, we are not making any transport arrangements because I'm quite sure you know where it is, and it's about 15 minutes walk.
If you walk, be very careful.
So,
Crazy.
Where is Sheraton?
Is it 15 minutes walk?
It is 15 minutes walk.
It's not there. It's right there. So where is it?
It's in Yashwantpura. Oh, it's about 30 minutes drive. Yeah, that's right. So, okay. But among the IISc students who do not know where it is, please get in touch with one of the volunteers. They will give you the direction. So please be here by 6:15.